On the issue of economics and the Dharma, I think it's, if you think about it, it's pretty straightforward. We don't want these practices to be denied to anyone. We want everyone to have access to the best instruction that they can have. As long as that happens, I don't think it really matters whether it's dana or a payment, or even a large payment.
Okay? 50,000 a week.
whatever, as long as we make sure that everyone on the planet that wants it can get it, and that our payment structures don't in some way inhibit equal access to the best teaching. As long as that's, as we assure that, does it really matter if we set an actual charge, even a large charge under some circumstances, as long as that money is being used or something is being done to make sure that everyone can get it. So I don't think that there's something evil about charging for it, personally, as long as that...
Such a relief after doing this for 20 years.
Now, my idea was, well, let's be creative. What are the problems that people have? Well, they might not be able to afford it, they can't travel, they can't leave their families. So... Well, is it feasible to bring retreats to people's homes via telephone? When you first think about it, it's like, wait, my house, telephone, meditating, doesn't compute.
I heard that you do this, and I just couldn't believe it. It made no sense to me whatsoever. And yet, whenever I've talked with people who've actually participated, they find it very effective. How did you evolve this?
It was a crazy idea that I didn't think would work either. as with many of the ideas I eventually used, suggested by a student. So I decided, well, let's just try it. I mean, can't hurt to try it. And it worked like a charm. It's counterintuitive because everybody thinks, it's like, wait, my house, that's what I have to leave in order to meditate. It's only going to be 4 hours long. There's not going to be a community around me, okay? It's telephone, it's like, what is it, like a speakerphone and headset? Yeah, speakerphone and headset. How do I afford it? Well, I'll get cheap Skype or, you know, whatever. And it just totally doesn't compute. But when we actually did it, it worked. Now, does it have all the great features of intense residential retreat? No, but the business model is so good, we charge $20. The business model is so good that we can give unlimited full scholarship indefinitely to anyone who wants it. So that's technology. Yeah. And no, it's not a residential, and no, I'm not saying it's a replacement for that, but it does pretty good, and you don't even have to leave your house. So that's what I meant by, well, let's just try out of the box things.
Yeah.
Diane, what about you?
So, well, I'm also doing a very similar thing. I have every morning koan study from 8 to 9 o'clock, and I see all my students for 10 minutes over Skype, and they pay for koan study. And I also do a weekly telecourse, and we have what's called the V Temple, which is one day a month. We actually do a full day retreat if you belong to the course, and we get on the phone. And we use the Maestro software, so I can break people into small groups for discussions with the Maestro software, and we just do a day of sitting with three talks and Q&As during the course of that, which I charge for. But I want to kind of, when I made that comment about $50,000, I was actually speaking from experience, because my teacher has always pushed my boundaries in terms of my own discomfort. And when he started charging to do a big mind session with him for 1 week, $50,000 for five people, so he would generate $250,000, I was pushed way out of my comfort zone in terms of what I thought was okay. And it was really interesting because I'm okay with people giving and doing it for free, and I'm okay with making a moderate living, but I noticed all of a sudden I had a big boundary around where I thought my own internal limit was. So I had to really, really look deeply into that question, particularly in American culture, which there's so many pockets of such affluence that he actually didn't struggle to fill those retreats. And his you know, he'd worked for many, many, many years practically giving away the Dharma. And what I saw was that I think that my own issue is not about the amount so much, but just the way in which, you know, greed, anger, and ignorance we're still subject to. And those are powerful energies. And so in a certain way, when we renounce sexuality and when we renounce income and when we renounce materialism, we free ourselves of having to work with the corrupting quality that can come from that. So it's a very deep yoga to work with a lot of money and to be willing to integrate it. And I think it's necessary and it's appropriate to our time and it has its challenges.
Was there something built into that organization to assure that people that could not afford would have access to equal high quality?
Yeah, always.
There you go.
I want to bring up another economic point, and that is the effect of the increase in productivity in the society on the cost of practice. Now, this was developed in the 1960s by an economist called Baumol. Very simple.
Well, what was the name again?
Baumol, B-A-U-M-O-L. And in Mozart's time, you had five violinists playing a Mozart quintet. And at the same time, you might have five carpenters, and they could build, say, a house in 3 months in that period. Fast forward to 200 years later, it still takes five violinists the same time to play the quintet. But those five guys can now build three houses in the same time or whatever. And the result of that is that the relative cost of the violin quintet, either to play it or to listen to it, is much higher than the cost of houses. And we talk about renunciation and so forth, but most people today live at a comfort level that was only available to royalty in the time of the Buddha. Mm-hmm. And so when people talk about renouncing in our lives, it actually costs a lot more than it did in the time of the Buddha. And I don't see this aspect being talked about at all. And it also comes the support of teachers, the creation of centers, as Rohan was talking about, the actual, because you cannot raise productivity when it comes to meditation. It takes a certain amount of time. It's like playing violin quintets. Mm-hmm. And the consequence of that is the actual cost of Dharma is steadily increasing in the same way that medical costs are. And I don't see this factor being, this influence being factored into people's thinking at all. And I think it is going to affect the emergent face of Buddhism. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.